I'm going to share a passage of Scripture with you that I've never preached in all my years of ministry. I would like for just a moment this morning, as we kind of launch into this whole thing in the message this morning, I want you to think about donkeys for a little bit. The reason that you laughed is that all of us have an opinion about donkeys. We have some thoughts about donkeys. Maybe we don't think about donkeys a whole lot, but even in our culture, we have certain derogatory names that we use in reference to donkeys, but we don't talk about donkeys. We're talking about people. So all of us have an opinion about donkeys, and there's certain words and certain thoughts that come to our mind about donkey, and none of them are probably positive. But let me ask you something this morning. Is it possible that a donkey could be smarter than you? And if you answer yes to that, then that must mean that you would be dumber than a... I didn't say it, you did. Is it possible that a donkey could have more spiritual insight and perception than you? Is it possible that God could use a donkey to get your attention and rescue you from your destructive decisions and choices? And the answer to that is yes. In fact, there's a story in Scripture that talks about that. If you have grown up in the church, you remember this story from when you were a little kid. It deals with the nation of Israel and a couple of individuals. Israel was God's chosen people who had lived in the land of Egypt for 430 years. God delivers them from their Egyptian slave masters. They have this amazing rescue, divine rescue, and now they're out in the wilderness for 40 years, led by the prophet Moses. Moses then leads them after 40 years across the Jordan River. They are now about to enter what would become known as the Promised Land, today's modern-day Israel. More than 1 million people, perhaps as many as 3 million people, covering the face of the earth, that wherever they went, whatever opposition met them was totally annihilated because God went before them. The first big opposition that they faced was the impenetrable city of Jericho, but even Jericho was no match for God and his people. Amongst the people that lived in the land when Israel was coming through, there was the nation of Moab, led by a guy named Balak, who was their king. Balak knew the reputation of Israel. He knew that Israel was on his doorsteps. There was no possible way in the natural to resist this incredible army. And so he made an appeal in the spiritual realm. He knew that in order to defeat this nation, he was going to have to appeal to a power that was spiritual and not physical. So he pulled out his phone and began its Google search for some kind of spiritual medium or spiritist, somebody who could place a curse on the nation of Israel. And then the number one hit on Google was a guy named Balaam. Balaam's prophetic services. And as he started to read the reviews, it was a 5-star review. If you want somebody blessed, you call Balaam. If you want him cursed, you call Balaam. You get results every time. And so he's going to summons this guy named Balaam. Now, Balaam is one of the key characters in our story. Balaam is a conflicted man. And this is possibly why it's taken me so long to share this message, because I didn't fully understand the passage as well until I studied it more. But Balaam is a conflicted man that spiritually had one foot on one side of the fence and had another foot on the other side of the fence, a lot like the people that go to church or don't go to church. We're not really sure if Balaam was a good prophet who had gone bad or if he was a bad prophet trying to do good, but he was a conflicted man. And you'll see it in the story as it bears out. He straddled the spiritual fence like people that you know. We can learn a lot from this man's life. So if you brought a Bible today and you have fun to follow along, we're going to be in the book of Numbers, found in the Old Testament part of your Bible, the fourth book in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and then Numbers. And we're going to be in Numbers chapter 22, and we're going to read the story about Balaam. So Balak now, he wants to go to Balaam to hire him to place a curse on the nation of Israel. And Balaam was all too willing because Balaam was a prophet for hire. I loved his money. And the story reads like this in verse number 7 of Numbers chapter 22. Balak's messengers, who were elders of Moab and Midian, they set out with money to pay Balaam to place a curse upon Israel. And they went to Balaam and they delivered Balak's message to him. Balak was simply saying, hey, I want you to come to Moab, get up on the hill, look at the nation of Israel and curse them. Balaam responds in verse number 8 to the messengers. He says, well, just stay here overnight. He says, in the morning I will tell you whatever the Lord wants me to say. So the officials from Moab stayed there with Balaam. This is where I believe Balaam is a conflicted man. It seems, it appears, it almost feels like he was a God follower. But his words and his actions didn't match up. So I don't know how God speaks to Balaam during the night. I don't know if it was an alphabet soup or alphabet cereal. I don't know if it was an oracle of God. I don't know if it was an angel of God. But somewhere in the middle of the night, God comes to Balaam and he says, don't go. Don't. And if you're going to remember or retain any one principle from what I'm going to share with you today, it's this one thing. When God says don't, don't. Well, the next morning, Balaam gets up and he goes to the messengers. Well, God said no, so I guess I'll just be staying here. And so the messengers go back to Balak and they go back empty-handed. No prophet in hand. No curse. Well, Balak is not going to be denied. So a second time, he sends a contingency of his officials to Balaam again. More important people and a bigger promise of money. The story goes on in verse 18, but Balaam responded to Balak's messengers a second time. Now, you know what? Even if Balak were to give me half his palace filled with silver and gold, I would be powerless to do anything against the will of my God. So this is where the story might get a little confusing. So Balaam again tells the messengers, you just wait here and I'll go to God and see what kind of an answer I get. And just like us, sometimes we don't like the first answer we got with God, so we'll go back and ask again. And so Balaam does. And during the night, this time, God says, go. Which causes me to scratch my head. Wait. God, you just said, don't go. Now you're saying, go. And I think as I read this scripture, I think God was dealing with Balaam the same way he deals with you and me. And you know what that is? God knows what we want to do, and we're going to do it anyway. So you might as well just go do it. I've already warned you. I warned you. I told you not to. I told you don't do this. I told you not to. But you're going to do it anyway, so just fine. Go right on ahead. So Balaam does. Isn't it just like us? Isn't it just like you and me? That in spite of all the warnings, we still do what we're going to do. Verse number 21, it says, so the next morning, Balaam, he got up and he saddled his donkey. And he started off with the Moabite officials, but God was angry that Balaam was going. Wait. God, you told him to go. You said go. So why are you mad at him for going? Because I didn't want him to go, but I knew he was going to go anyway. And so it says, so God was angry with him that he was going. So he sent an angel of the Lord to stand in the road, and block his way. One version of the Bible says to send an angel to stand as an adversary. You know what? There are things that happen in people's lives sometimes, and I've heard people say this. It's like God is mad at me. There are times when God is opposed to what you're doing and the way you're living and the choices and the decisions that you're making. So he sends angels and messengers to stand in your way to frustrate you. And you get mad at God for it. And God is standing as an adversary opposed to what you're doing because he loves you. Sometimes God opposes us that way, so he sends us messengers. Believe it or not, the messenger might be your mother-in-law. The messenger might be your mama. The messenger might be your best friend. And those messengers stand in your path over and over and over again. And you've heard those messengers, but you didn't want to listen to them because you wanted to do what you wanted to do. Are you sure you want to marry this guy? And there's all kinds of warnings. Your friend said no, your mama said no, but he looked good and he drove a nice truck. Are you sure you want to go in debt for that? Are you sure that you can't work it out? Are you sure that leaving your spouse is the best thing to do? Are you sure you want to move in with him? Are you sure you want to have her in your life? Have you really thought this through? No, but I'm going to do it anyway. And in the story that we're reading, Balaam is a prophet who only sees profit. And sometimes when we want to do something, we can falsely interpret the circumstances because we want something to happen so bad, we can falsely interpret the circumstances and think it's God's intervention. It's his answer to my prayer. I was so alone. My spouse wasn't fulfilling my needs. And so I went out and I was just having a drink and he walked in and he was so nice to me. It's like God knew that I needed him. And then I've heard this time and time again as a pastor, well, doesn't God want me to be happy? No. He wants you to be obedient. But God doesn't give up on us even when we are acting like a donkey. Did I just say that? Verse 23, well, as Balaam and his two servants were riding along, remember they're following now this contingency of Moabites to go curse the nation of Israel, Balaam's donkey saw an angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand. Donkey saw it. So the donkey bolted off the road into a field, but Balaam beat it to turn it back onto the road. We're in the wide open spaces, and we're traveling down the road, and Balaam's on the back of the donkey, and suddenly off the side of the road it goes, and he gets his staff and beats it. He beats it on the neck until the donkey, in compliance to its master, gets back on the road again. So verse 24 says, then the angel of the Lord stood in a place where the road narrowed between two vineyard walls. The road now narrows, maybe not much more than the aisle in front of me. And on each side of the road, there are rocks that are stacked up to keep people out of the vineyards. They're made of stones, and he's riding on the back of this donkey. And now the angel is standing right there, and verse 25 says that when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, it tried to squeeze by, and it crushed Balaam's foot against the wall. So Balaam beat the donkey again. Get back on the... What are you doing? He's mad because now my foot hurts. It's probably bleeding as it's scraped along the shards of stone in that wall. Verse 25. Then the angel of the Lord moved further down the road and stood in a place too narrow for the donkey to get by at all. This whole episode sounds like my life. And it sounds like your life. And it sounds like the life of somebody that you know. And you know what that is? It's this. The things started to get a little bit miserable with the choices and decisions that you or somebody that you know is making. And then it got even more miserable. It got even more difficult. And then it got worse yet. It's almost as if, just like Balaam's out in the wide open fields, and the donkey can go down in a field, there's no consequences. But now he's in a narrower place. There's a rock wall on each side of the pass until finally you can't go any further. It's almost like God is funneling your life or somebody that you know down to the point where you have to listen to him. And you're so bent on doing what you want to do, it seemed like a good idea at the time. In fact, it seemed like God was putting all the pieces together so that I could have, that I could get, that I could do. And then things aren't really working out. And you know who we first blame when things don't work out? Oh, because we invoked the name of God. We even thought about God. We even thought that our circumstances was an answer to prayer from God. So the first person that we're mad at when things don't work out is God. Sometimes it just seems like God's putting all the pieces together for us, but God's not putting the pieces together for us. He's pursuing us. And verse 27 says that this time when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord had just laid down under Balaam in a fit of rage, Balaam, he beat the animal again with a staff. You stupid beast, get up, stand to your feet, what are you doing? Maybe you've known somebody with that kind of a blind rage, beating the animal with a stick. It's a good thing the ASPCA wasn't there. And then the story gets tragicomical in the next verse. Verse 28 says, the Lord gave the donkey the ability to speak. Whoa. Okay, wait. This is a great story. Like, I get the whole Jesus on the cross thing, the whole Easter resurrection thing, the whole baby Jesus thing. I get that. But this donkey to talk, come on, Pastor. I realize there's a lot of things in Scripture that are just allegorical to kind of help us understand the principle, right? Look. Just hang on with me, Bill. Who invented the earth? God. I think he did, right? Who invented you? I think God did. Who invented the donkey? I think God did. And if God could invent a donkey, don't you think he could make it talk? That's where I'm at on the whole thing. So the donkey's talking. He says, look. What have I done to you that deserves your beating me three times? Now, what's amazing here is the donkey is not speaking some great spiritual oracle over Balaam. He's just asking what a beaten donkey would ask the beater. What are you doing? Story gets funnier. Verse 29. Balaam answers the question, you made me look like a fool. If I had a sword, I'd kill you right now. Wait. Who made whom look like a fool? You're talking to the donkey. Right? Isn't it amazing, though, that the story doesn't stop here and say at some point he realized he was talking to a donkey. When men, I don't know about women, but when men get into a blind rage, they just lose all sense of sensitivity and normalcy, and they can just go berserk and nuts. And ladies, don't shout me down and go, preach it. No, I'm just telling you, this is the way a man works, that he gets so tunnel visioned, he can't see anything literally in the periphery. That's physically what happens when a man is in a blind rage. He can only see straight ahead. And I think all that he can see is that his will, his way is being frustrated by the stupid animal. So it really doesn't matter that he's talking to a donkey. The donkey says in verse number 30, look, I'm the same donkey you've ridden all your life. Have I ever done anything like this before? No. And then in verse 31, the Lord opened Balaam's eyes. You know what? There's a lot of spiritual things we can't see because our eyes are closed. We refuse to see them. We don't want to see them. We are so bent on our plan, our agenda, our goal, our will, our end game. So God has to open our eyes. The person that you've been praying for, your children, your parents, your spouse, you're frustrated, you're just upset by it. Why can't they just give? God has to open their eyes. And so God opens Balaam's eyes, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the roadway with a drawn sword in his hand. And Balaam bowed with his head, and he fell face down to the ground before him. Verse 32, why did you, a lot of questions for Balaam, aren't there? Balaam, why did you beat the donkey those three times? The angel of the Lord demanded, look, I have come to block your way because you are stubbornly resisting me. If you have frustrations and difficulties in your life that cause you to say, why does God hate me? Why is he so mad at me? Why doesn't he let me? Why can't I have? Why can't I do? For the person that you know and life just seems to be a shamble, it could be that God is standing in your path, in their path, because you're stubbornly resisting him. Isn't it amazing in this story that we normally associate stubbornness with a donkey, but the stubborn one in the story wasn't the donkey, it was Balaam. Stubbornly resisting God. Is that you today? Somebody invited you to church today. You're probably looking at them right now like, well, this isn't a very happy message. Like, just get me out of here. Let's go eat lunch. We wouldn't have to stubbornly resist God if God didn't lovingly, passionately pursue us. He never gives up on us. Verse 33. Three times the donkey saw me and shied away. Otherwise, I would have certainly killed you by now and spared the donkey. Want to get away? And in the story, in verse 34, Balaam, he just confessed to the angel of the Lord, you know what, I've sinned. I didn't realize it was you standing in the road to block my way. I'll return home if you're against my going. You know what's tragic about this whole thing? It was a confession, but it wasn't repentance. It was an admission of guilt. It was an admission of saying, yep, okay, I'm found out. I mean, how can you deny a talking donkey and an angel with a drawn sword, right? You found me out. But tragically, when you read the rest of Balaam's story in this and the next chapter and all the references to him throughout the New Testament, Balaam wasn't a changed man. But he confessed. And he lived out the rest of his life with one foot over here and one foot over here, straddling the fence. Before Balaam could learn a thing from God, he had to first learn something from a donkey. Maybe in your life, there's heartbreaks and frustrations and bewilderments and anger and resentment towards God. Reality is God's just been trying to stop you from pursuing headlong your folly, with going through with the indebtedness, with going through the divorce, with going through the separation, with going through the relationship that you want so bad, and your mama says no, your daddy says no, your friends say no, but you know what you want and you're going to have it anyway. With the habit that just tangles your life, you want it, and when life gets miserable, the first person that you blame is God, and God's not to blame. When God says don't, don't. When God says don't, don't. So, is it possible for a donkey to be smarter than you if you are stubbornly resisting God? Then the answer is yes.